Okay, so Pepe told me that he's not going to introduce me because, well, he thinks everybody knows me. So, I've given mini courses on complex hyperbolic geometry for many, many years. And looking around the audience, I think that probably at least half of the people have been to at least one of them. And it's going to be the same. Okay? Some people haven't. So, but it's more or less the same. And I've been giving these notes out, or versions of these notes, they're slowly evolving for a very long time. I think you'll see my acknowledgements. I think the first time I gave them out was in 2003 in Lumini. They are still the evolving first chapter of a book which is still evolving at an increasingly slow pace. It's sort of converging a little bit like a log function. But eventually, it will get to within epsilon of being finished. And also, because it's supposed to be being published, I've asked for them to give you hard copies, which everybody should have in their mailbox, which is around the corner. And I'm also asking you, please don't put it online, because I don't want to get in trouble with my publishers. Or at least, if you put it online now, it's your fault and not mine, because I've told you not to. I sort of got two aims. First, I want to give you enough background in complex hyperbolic geometry so that the people who next week are giving talks in the subject, you will at least have some basic knowledge. But also, this week is supposed to be a school, and we have many topics, and I want to try to link in what I'm talking about to a little bit about the very beginning, what Todd talked about. We're going to see connections with what Bertrand talked about, what Pepe is going to talk about, and maybe even what Francois is going to talk about. But I'm going to try to at least give you sort of pointers as to how you can glue these little mini courses together so that you have a bigger knowledge. So most of the time, I'm going to be thinking about H2C, which I write like this, which is complex hyperbolic two-space. And I'm also going to be thinking about C21, which is a complex vector space, which is the complex version of the thing that Todd talked about. And I'm going to do both of those to keep everything definite. All of these notes are exclusively about those cases. But just before we start, I thought I would just sort of try to paint a slightly bigger picture, one of which includes some of these other things that we've been talking about. And incidentally, because all of the mathematical details are in here, I'm going to be a little bit freer about trying to explain ideas and draw pictures. And if you want to know the proper mathematical proofs, you can follow them in here. Okay? So the main context, I mean, I'm going to use some fancy words now. You know, because, well, some of us like to write grant proposals, and if we put fancy words into our grant proposals, then they're more likely to get funded, which reminds me of the story that Jonathan Hillman, who's a knot theorist from Sydney, told me that they had a very big grant proposal. He works in knot theory, and so it was the title of the proposal was something like knot theory. And he said he's been working on it. It was thick, you know, lots of money, lots of postdocs, lots of grants, lots of conferences. And so the day before he was due to submit it, somebody who kind of had got their ear open to something going on higher up with the Ministry of Education or whoever it was, said, "They're not going to fund it because the title sounds too simple." So they just changed the title to "On Codimension 2 Embeddings." And, oh, fantastic, fantastic. And they got funded. So sometimes you have to use complicated words to describe simple things in order to get funded. So here's some complicated words, not because of funding, but just to give you a little bit of a context. So the rank one symmetric spaces of non-compact type so symmetric space is a space where every point looks the same. Why is it that? What's the real definition? It means that it's a space where you have the tangent space at every point, so it's got to be sufficiently nice to have a tangent space, then minus the identity, which you always have on every tangent space, that pushes down to an isometry. And because of that, then it has to look the same everywhere. So if I have two points, I can join them by a geodesic, because I'm assuming it's sufficiently nice that I have geodesics. Then I take the midpoint, and then that minus the identity switches the direction of that geodesic, so what it looked like there is what it looked like over there. Okay, so the symmetric space, that's roughly what that means. And rank one means that if I have a geodesic, then that is a locally isometric embedding of the real line. And rank one means that is the highest dimension of any Euclidean space that I can locally isometrically embed into my space. So a sphere would be a case, because even though with a sphere, when I'm going around a great circle, that's not an embedding of the real line, but locally it is an embedding of the real line. So that's why I'm saying locally isometric embedding. And non-compact type, because I don't want to think about spheres, or CPN, or whatever. I want to think about the other ones. And so these are sometimes called the hyperbolic spaces. And these are usually called HNR. People often forget the R there. HNC, so this is real hyperbolic space. And people often will not use real. So this is complex hyperbolic space. This is quaternionic hyperbolic space. And notice, this is why I use an ordinary boldface H in my notes, because as soon as I'm wanting to do things over the quaternions, I have a problem if I have a blackboard bold H sub blackboard bold H, because I don't know whether it's hyperbolic quaternionic hyperbolic space or hyperbolic quaternion space. And I have H2O, which some people think is water, but the two goes up and down. This is octonionic hyperbolic 2 space. All right, and that's a complete classification. And, well, the last one's a little bit of an exception. But the general framework that I'm going to talk about will work in all of those cases. And if you're prepared to be sufficiently broad-minded, you can make it work in this case as well. So the things that Todd was talking about and what Bertrand was talking about all fit. Well, actually, what Todd was talking about fits in here. What Bertrand was talking about fits in here, but with n equals 1. And there's this low-dimensional accident that real hyperbolic 2 space and complex hyperbolic 1 space are the same. And that is exactly the same as the low-dimensional accident that CP1, which is the compact analog, is the same as S2. But as soon as I go to higher dimensions, CPN is not the same as SN for any n other than these low dimensions. Okay, and we're going to see both of those both pieces of that phenomenon coming in. Sorry, what?
What's the reason you only have two
Okay, so we can also have one, but H1O would be the same as HR8, and because again, there's a low dimensional accident there, and you don't have any more because the problem is associativity. Okay, in the same way that the compact type symmetric spaces of rank one would be the real spheres, the CPNs, the HPNs, and O, whatever it is, OP2. The same thing happens there. Right.
One H is also H4R.
Eight, that's right. So H1C is H2O. H2R, blah, 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 blah. H1H is H4R, and H1O is H8R. And I think if I've read the abstracts correctly, we're going to be seeing something about this connection later on, probably next week. So this is talking about four-dimensional real hyperbolic space viewed from the point of view of it being one-dimensional quaternionic hyperbolic space, which is also a very interesting topic, which I've thought about at some point. Incidentally, you can sort of continue this sort of line here. This sort of line, but if you're prepared to go up into Clifford algebras, and you can describe real hyperbolic N space in terms of Clifford algebras as 2x2 matrices over Clifford algebras. That would be an entirely different mini course, and I've also got a set of notes about that, which you can find on my webpage. But that also fits into this broad context that I'm talking about. So I'm going to give you some formulae, and I'm going to mainly concentrate on this case, but I will tell you when they apply in this amount of generality. Good. So let's start slowly. Because, well, it's the first day of the conference, it's after lunch, it's raining, all these things. When Todd was talking this morning, he took transposes of his vectors.
So H1 of the Clifford algebra is what? Clifford algebra dimension N?
So perhaps this is a good question for the problem session, but you what you so you end up with the Clifford algebra is a problem because it has zero divisors. And so you'll have to look inside the Clifford algebra, you get the Clifford vectors, and then you have the Clifford group, which is the multiples of Clifford vectors together with zero. You take matrices over those, but they act on this space of vectors. And you get and the matrices that these Clifford matrices, there's certain compatibility conditions which I guess were found by Wahlen in 1902 and rediscovered by Mars and then popularized by Alfors, but those conditions are exactly the same as your matrices having to preserve a Clifford Hermitian form. And so you can rephrase the whole setup in terms of Hermitian forms, which is what I'm going to be talking about, and linear algebra. But as I say, that's something we can either talk about in the problem session, or you can look at my notes, or we can talk about privately. But it's going to take me too far away from what I want to do. Okay, so, right, let's try to get some of the, rather than talking about abstract things, let's come down to earth. So I'm going to be thinking about what is C, let's just start with CN1. N's going to be 2 very quickly, but C could be R or H. I want you to think about this as vectors like this, which would be, I always think of column vectors because, well, my first postdoctoral advisor was the same as Todd's thesis advisor, and he likes to think in columns, and he's influenced us the same way. And I always, when I want, we always like, when we transpose, we like to Hermitian transpose. So this is going to be, right, so whenever you see a star, that is going to mean conjugate transpose. And this is equipped with a Hermitian form, so this would be H, which is an n plus 1 by n plus 1 matrix. So again, H star is supposed to be H conjugate transpose. And being Hermitian means that that equals H. So this is just the complex analog of being symmetric, a symmetric matrix. And so I can now have a form, which I'm going to always use angle brackets. And this is where, well, there's some sort of convention. And I don't know whether it's because I learned linear algebra in England where they drive on the left, but I always like my Hermitian forms to be linear in the first variable and conjugate linear in the second variable. And I think that's because that we drive on the left, and that seems the natural way to do it. It's a little bit like I tell my second year complex analysis students that the reason why you go anti-clockwise around a contour when you're integrating is because Cauchy was French, and therefore when he went round roundabouts, he went round them on the right-hand side, whereas the English people would have gone the other way around. And that way they remember which way to integrate around a contour. It's great. Anyway. I always have to switch here, so it's going to be W star H Z. So it's a nice linear algebra form, so you should just think about that is the same as X dot Y is Y transpose X, which in that case would be X transpose Y. It's the same, it's an analog of that formula. But that's because we would be in the real case, and of course we notice that right, simply because when I transpose, I reverse the order while taking transposes of everything. So when I conjugate, I have to reverse the order. Right, good. So now. I need this, that would be a general thing, and as we heard, some people don't like to call things inner products if they're indefinite, but perhaps we can just call it a product. And I want H to have signature N, 1, which is the reason for this N1, i.e. N positive eigenvalues and 1 negative eigenvalue. Notice that that's used up all my dimension, and so that would have to be 0 eigenvalues. So that's very much the same as the product that Todd was denoting by a dot, except that he was in the real world this morning, I'm in the complex world. And I could go into the quaternionic, and if I was a bit more careful, into the octonionic world. You see, In the octonionic world, I fail at this stage. Because I no longer have a vector space, because scalar multiplication is no longer associative. And therefore, I have to go through all sorts of gymnastics in order to avoid ever mentioning the word vector space. But once I go through those gymnastics, I can deal with matrices, I can deal with all sorts of stuff, but I just have to be very careful because I don't have a vector space. So there are going to be some standard examples. So I'm going to be so standard. Examples, I'm going to call H1 the matrix with a whole load of plus ones down the diagonal followed by a minus one. And so in this case, we would have ZW1. If I am independent of which form I'm choosing, I'm not going to put a subscript. Otherwise, I'll record it there just to help things. That would just be Z1 W1 bar plus Zn Wn bar minus Zn plus 1 Wn plus 1 bar. And this is the most basic one. We call this one the first Hermitian form. Took that notation from a paper of David Epstein. And H2 is going to be, I'm going to divide my matrix up into blocks. I'm going to have ones there. I'm going to have the identity matrix of size n minus one there, and zeros everywhere else. And so in the particular, in the case when n equals 3, that's just going to be the standard off-diagonal matrix, which we're going to call the second Hermitian form. And so that would mean that this would be Z1 Wn plus 1 bar plus Z2 W2 bar plus Zn minus 1, no, Zn Wn bar plus Zn plus 1 W1 bar. Right. It's a small exercise to show that that's also got signature 2, 1, and if you're bored at this stage, you can prove it for me. What I want to do is I want to, as far as possible, avoid getting bogged down in particular normalizations and give you formulae that work in general, which you can then apply to your favorite situation and then use that. So that saves me, you'll see, saves me from having to kind of worry about the upper half plane versus the unit disk. I can just do everything at once and then say, okay, just specialize here, specialize there. Another Hermitian form which we might see next week when Martin's talking is if you have a triangle group. I'm now skipping way ahead, but we'll come back to this, but this is just a sort of a little flag for you. So if I have a triangle group, so that would be the group generated by complex reflections in certain complex lines, let's just stick to n equals 2 here. As Todd was talking about, you have these light cone pictures, and then any complex line sitting inside there has got a normal vector. And if I have a triangle sitting in there, I can't possibly draw three of these, then I would get three normal vectors which would be linearly independent. And so I could choose n1, n2, n3, which would be by definition going to be positive vectors that don't yet have a form. I could just choose those to be the standard basis, and then I would immediately pick up a matrix whose entries would be the different Hermitian products, and that's sometimes called a Gram matrix. So I could have H as a Gram matrix, which would be something like the matrix Ni, Nj. Right, so the ijth entry would be, you know, whatever it was. So I need to find this. You know, I can find this somehow by geometry, what these numbers should be, and then I just plug it in. And providing this has got signature 2-1, then that should also be a good example. Right? And the cases that I've been interested in when dealing with Martin and have been of where there's a lot of symmetry, so you would have something like 1a, a bar, 1, 1. You would have something like this, where a is some complex number, and you would then have to convince yourself that this has got signature, the right signature, which is some condition on the a's. Good. So if I just were to take a Hermitian product of a vector with itself, then that has to be equal. I can swap the two factors around. If I swap the two factors around, I complex conjugate, and I get the same answer because they're both the same. And so it must be real. And there's a great thing about real numbers. They're either positive, negative, or zero. So I'm going to have V plus is the set of all Z in C21 such that ZZ's positive, V zero. I don't like the origin because I'm going to very soon I'm going to do complex projectivization to get down to CP2. I don't like the origin, so I'm going to get rid of that. So all the people who are equal to zero and V minus and I'm going to draw pictures that look like a light cone, right? So out here is V plus, here is V zero, and in there is V minus. And of course, I'm removing the origin, so there's a little hole there. This is very schematic because I don't have to worry about future and past, because future and past are all one to me, because future is plus one, past is minus one, but I have a whole circle worth that goes between them, and so really that picture is a little bit misleading. Yeah? But that would be the picture if I intersected with the real numbers for the first Hermitian form, because I would have my Z3 axis here and my Z1 axis and my Z2 axis, and that really would be the usual light cone that you would see. On the other hand, if I were to do this second Hermitian form, it's not so difficult to discover that if I have my Z3, my Z1, and my Z2, maybe it's good to have a slightly different colour at this stage, and let me try to get this right, that my cone should sit, it has both the Z3 axis and the Z1 axis on it, and it sort of sits like that. So this is an illustration of what I was saying, that you know, we're going to have different formulae involved in different cases, but I can just sort of move things around by changing my Hermitian form, and everything looks the same. Bless you. Moment. The chalk is all very short, so it's you'll notice the speakers keep going down there. It's not because of the chocolates in there. Right. So I want to go from C to 1. I want to do a canonical projection onto CP2, perhaps I should say minus the origin, because, and that's the usual canonical projection, right? I just identify all complex scalar multiples of vectors. Notice that I've gone down to 2 already, that's just habit. And then, I'm going to call this P. Let's just call it P like that. And then a complex hyperbolic 2 space, the projective model, is going to just be PV minus, and its boundary is going to be PV0. Whoa, look at this. No expense spared. You can tell the UNs behind this. Okay. You watch me break it into tiny fragments within 30 seconds. I'll really try not to. Okay, so this is my space. It's a projective model, just like we saw the projective model this morning. But maybe we don't like to actually think too hard about a projective model, because that can be a little bit tricky. So let's try to think of some slightly more concrete models. So I'm going to think, first of all, about the first Hermitian form. And so this would be the set of all points Z with Z1. Well, let's just stick to 2. That being negative. Notice that Z3 cannot be 0 in this case. So I can divide through by Z3. So this means Z3 is non-zero. And so if I just change the name of this into a new inhomogeneous coordinate, then I just get the unit ball in C2. And that would be the same as intersecting with the plane where Z3 was equal to 1. Plane, complex 2 space. And so here, that would be the plane where Z3 is 1. And you can see that I intersect my light cone in a nice, well, what looks like a disk there, but really, if I'm doing it in the correct dimensions, should be a copy of the unit ball in C2. Similarly, if I do the same thing for H2, again, I'm just going to let Z3 be equal to 1, then I would get that twice the real part of Z1 plus mod Z2 squared has to be less than 0. And this is some sort of paraboloid that you can see. And if I do that over here, then that's supposed to be Z3 is 1, and over here I'm going to get a paraboloid, and this is called the Ziegle domain. Ooh, you see, happened already. So let's just stop for a moment and think about what would happen if I decided that 2 was a big, too big a number for me and that I had just taken 1 instead. If I'd taken just 1 instead, in this case, it's quite easy to see that I would be coming down to CP1, which is the Riemann sphere. And in here, I would be having mod z squared is less than 1. I would be having the unit disk in the Riemann sphere. So let's just record this fact that if n equals 1, we get CP1, which is the Riemann sphere, and the H1 is going to lead to the unit disk. And in the second case, I don't have a Z2 anymore. I'm going to be having the real part of Z is less than 0. This is a left half plane. Which I don't really like, the left half plane, because it's far more conventional to use the upper half plane. And so what I could do, oh dear, you put this on top of there, didn't you? That was, never mind. Now, I told you, were you timing how long it took me to reduce all the chalk? Oh gosh, right. Never mind, eh? Okay, so if I instead took something like a Hermitian form, let's just call it H2 tilde, this is in one dimension, and 0 minus II 0, then this is going to give me the upper half plane. So this is, in some sense, really complicated language, but what I've derived so far are these very, very familiar objects of the unit disk and the upper half plane, just the spaces at the moment. We haven't yet got a metric, we haven't yet got isometries, but they're coming very quickly. And I'm actually told you how to generalize it, well, to 2 complex dimensions, or actually to n complex dimensions, actually to n real dimensions, to n quaternionic dimensions, doing a similar thing, you can do stuff with Clifford algebras, and with a little bit of gymnastics, you can get the octonions. So somehow, what we saw as a little seed of this stuff that we know, you can, by putting some fertilizer on it, it grows into all sorts of things. And it's a great fun game to then take results that you know for the unit disk and the upper half plane and to see what's going to be true if I generalize them to some of these contexts. And it's such fun that I've been doing this for rather more years than I care to think about. And I'm still not bored with it. Right. For arbitrary real n, I'm just going to get the standard SON model, SON1 model. Yes? Yes? So
Clifford algebras, by putting certain restrictions.
Yes?
You can represent by 2 by 2 matrices.
Right, so in that case, what you would end up with is you can have 2 different Hermitian forms. You could have the Hermitian form like that, yeah? And that's going to give you the unit ball model. Now we're working over the Clifford algebras, right? Hermitian form over the Clifford algebras, and we have to be a little bit careful about stuff, but we will be that careful if you want. Or I could have 0 minus ik, and that's going to give me an upper half plane model of Clifford algebras. And in fact, it's this one that you can find in Alfour's paper. But he doesn't have, he never mentions the word Hermitian form. But actually, perhaps I either want a k plus 1 or n plus 1. Maybe n is probably a better number there. Maybe it's n or n plus 1, I don't know. Depends on whether you start from 0 or 1. But it needs a little bit of work, because the fun thing you're dealing with there is you're dealing with Clifford vectors, which when you add them together give vectors, but when you multiply them don't give vectors. And you're multiplying by also working with the Clifford group, which when you multiply them together give you elements in the Clifford group, but when you add them doesn't. So you have to be very careful about separating out your adding and your multiplying and making sure that when you add, you only ever add vectors, and when you multiply, you only ever multiply things in the group. But it works. It works. Right. So those are the basic spaces. So now, here's a formula for the metric. Now, I don't have a good way to motivate this. Perhaps your motivation could be like my motivation was I was reading Mostow's book on symmetric spaces, and it came from there. I don't know how Mostow found it, but here's a formula. I'm going to put a minus 4 there. That's going to determine the curvature. But if you want to have different curvatures, you put a different constant there. That's a formula. And I seem to have got a round bracket and a closed bracket. Let's be consistent. And that formula is going to give you the metric, the real hyperbolic metric if you're in the real spaces. It's going to be the Klein-Beltrami metric. Or it's going to give you the complex hyperbolic metric, the Bergman metric, or in one dimension, the Poincaré metric. Or it's going to give you the quaternionic hyperbolic metric. And you have to, do a little bit more gymnastics, because there's an extra term to deal with non-associativity for the octonians. But it's a single formula that does for everything. And that's always how I remember what the formula is for the metric in any particular case. So if you want, if you want to have a little bit of something to do this evening because it's still be raining, then you could use the Hermitian form given by 0 minus I0 and check that you pick up exactly the metric that we saw from Bertrand. Okay? And his factor of 4 is exactly the same as my factor of 4. If you were to try to do it over the reals and to try to pick up the metric that Todd didn't actually mention this morning but was implicit in what he said, then you would find you probably don't have a factor of 4 there, because in fact this is going to give you, in that case you want to have something with curvature minus 1, and this is going to give you curvature minus a quarter. If you use that formula in that case. So, providing you don't mind about changing your constant in the different contexts, then... So that's a formula, and it's going to give you a metric in all of these different cases. In case you don't like the metric, you can derive a distance function. And so and this is essentially going to be, a little bit like... The Cauchy-Schwarz formula. So this is going to be, so we're going to have a distance function. So this should be, in the context I'm dealing with, this is the Bergman metric, which generalizes the Poincaré metric. And then we have a distance formula. So I'm going to have rho of points. I know what I've forgotten to tell you, but never mind. I'll write down the formula and I'll tell you what I forgot. I had it in my notes, but if I'd looked at my notes more carefully, I would have. Right? So I grew up where the hyperbolic metric was always called rho. My advisor was Alan Bearden. That's what he used in his book. That's what I learned from, you know, being, well, however high I was when I was a PhD student. And I can't possibly ever imagine any other name for the hyperbolic metric. So some people from some other cultural backgrounds find that using rho as for a metric is a little bit odd, but I'm afraid this is what it is. So this is the for this distance function. So that's what it is. Rho is a distance function, and it's given by cosh squared of the distance between z and w over 2 is zw wz over zz ww. And what I forgot to tell you was how I'm relating a point here without an underline to a vector here with an underline. And that's to do with exactly these pictures that I'm about to erase. So if I have z1, z2 in C2, then that's going to correspond to, which is z, it's going to correspond to the vector z, z1, z2, 1, and I'm just going to call, which is in C2, 1, and I'm going to call this a standard lift. What's my motivation for that? Well, when we're thinking about CP1, we know that CP1 is C union infinity, and we do this by taking Z1, Z2, and identifying it to Z1 over Z2, 1, which we can think of as Z union 1, 0. And so, because I kind of grew up in this complex analysis world, you know, I always think of it as the Riemann sphere, C union infinity, and there's my variable C. When I want to lift it up to a vector, then it becomes something like that. And so that's what my motivation for is over here. So that this point corresponds to infinity. When I'm dealing with the unit ball, I can extend this. This can go, the unit ball sits inside here. But the Ziegle domain, as you can imagine from this picture that I've just missed off there, that goes off to infinity. And so I'm going to have a point infinity. It's going to have its standard lift as 1, 0, 0, which is just the natural generalization of this standard lift of infinity here. And that's exactly why, that's how I think about it. So my, you know, when I started doing this game, I had all this knowledge about, you know, the Riemann sphere and hyperbolic space and discrete groups of Möbius transformations and things, and I just wanted to see, well, how is this going to generalize in this world? And so the things that I started then and are now so ingrained in me I couldn't possibly change, they all have this sort of motivation. Good. So it may be that I've taken something that you know and love and I've written it in a really bizarre way because and told you that it's going to generalize. Probably true. But now I'm going to tell you why what I've just done is actually going to make life a lot easier for us. Because I've just done a lot of hard work. And if you do hard work, you want to have a payoff. So the payoff is I'm going to be able to write down isometries of all of these metrics really, really easily. Okay, so where should I go? Let's just keep the formula for the metric at the moment. So I'm going to say that if H is going to be a Hermitian form, U of H is the unitary group with respect to this form. So this is going to be all matrices A such that AZ AW equals ZW for all ZW. And I've deliberately not quite told you where my spaces are, because that's going to work for any dimensions. Well, unitary is implying that there's complex here. If I had done this over the reals, this would have been O of, I guess, a symmetric matrix over the reals, and it would have been called SP, standing for symplectic, over the quaternions. And so the same thing is sort of holding. So let's deconstruct what this really means just in matrix terms. So let's first of all write out the right hand side. The right hand side was that we had ZW was W star H Z. Now this is supposed to be equal to AZ AW. So let's use the same formula here. So I'm going to get AW star H AZ. But just like with ordinary transposes, when you take a transpose of a product, Hermitian transpose of a product, it's the Hermitian transpose of the elements, but the opposite way round. And so this is equal to W star A star H A Z. And that's supposed to work for all W and Z. So that means that I can just get rid of those, get rid of those. And so I would have a formula that H is equal to A star H A. And that is the generalization of the standard formula that you know for when H is the identity matrix and you're dealing with over the reals, that if you have an orthogonal matrix, then its inverse is its transpose. Yeah? Because if I was over the reals, this star would become a transpose. If I had the identity matrix, I'd just have A transpose A is the identity. So that gives me a clue. Well, maybe I could actually write the inverse of my matrix A. And so H is invertible. It had no zero eigenvalues. And so this means that I can immediately write that A inverse is H inverse A star H. So another exercise. Another exercise would be if I took this 0 minus I 0 Hermitian form and I put complex matrices in and I said that the inverse had to satisfy this formula, let's just suppose that the determinant was equal to 1, then what would drop out would be the entries had to be real. And so I would immediately be getting SL2R. SL2R, those were the isometries of my metric. Well, it's clear because of this formula that if I apply A, both of these formulae only involve the Hermitian form, and so it's automatic that everything that preserves the Hermitian form is an isometry because they preserve these formulae. So that's a sort of a very convoluted way of saying that elements of SL2R act on the hyperbolic plane, on the upper half plane, as isometries, right? Which was what we heard in the last lecture. But I've probably changed it into such a bizarre and complicated statement that it's a little bit difficult, but it's my motivation, it's the thing I should keep in the back of my mind, that this is what I'm just generalizing. Yeah? Good. And a similar formula is going to work. Okay, so that's some of the isometries. Can we think of any other isometries? Yes, we can. Well, if I were to send if I just complex conjugate my vector z, what happens to my Hermitian form? Well, it just complex conjugates. So and so I immediately see that I get complex conjugation here. Let's just record this. A in U of H is an isometry and complex conjugation is an isometry. Then I need to show that those are all of the isometries. And perhaps we could mimic this sort of argument we heard earlier, but a much more low-tech way of doing it, and you can find that as a proof in the notes, which is somewhere, let's see. Theorem 3.10 in the notes. That these are all the isometries, or rather that they generate all the isometries, because I can compose an element of UH with a complex conjugation. And the way I proved this was I mimicked the analogous proof in Bearden's book. Namely, I take any isometry I like. I didn't actually tell you that A acts transitively on my space. It does. There's a little proof of that in the notes. Then I can always assume that it fixes the origin in the ball model. Now I can compose with a rotation, so a point somewhere on the real axis, that point always goes to somewhere on the positive real axis. I think I chose a half. That always goes to a point on the positive real axis, again by applying elements of U of H. And then once I have that data, it's easy to show that it fixes the half, then it has to fix all points on that real axis. And then you keep on going, and it has to fix points on the imaginary axis, and eventually you discover that map has to either be identity or complex conjugation. And so that shows you that any element, any isometry, is either in U of H, or it's U of H followed by complex conjugation. Very, very low-tech argument, which I quite like. I like low-tech. Now, how does this act? How does this act on my space? So, well, A of Z, well, the first thing I have to do is I have to take my standard lift of Z, and then I multiply by my matrix, and then I projectivize. And that's exactly the argument that we got earlier on when we were seeing how elements of SL2R acted on the upper half plane. Because what happened was I took my, so that was the same, so think Z goes to Z1, goes to A, B, C, D, Z1, which is AZ plus B, CZ plus D. All right, that's just multiplication, goes to by projectivization, AZ plus B over CZ plus D. It's the same argument as we had before, and it works here. So what I could in fact do is I could write these transformations as complex projective maps in two variables where the denominator in both cases is the same. I've never found a really useful way of using that formulation, but it's true. And so, just like we had before, we have to see what would happen, what happens with, there's a kernel here. So the identity, clearly it maps as the identity, but there are other maps that would act as the identity. And it's not so difficult to see that all scalar multiples of the identity are going to act trivially. And so what I'm going to go from is U of H. To PU of H. So I can go from U of H, right? Well, that was what I was dealing with, but then scalar multiples of the identity, so let's just say lambda I acts trivially, right? Because over there, I'm going to get lambda as a thing and then I projectivize it, goes away. And so I'm going to define PU of H to be U of H quotiented out by lambda I. By the way, because it's unitary, its determinant is going to have to be 1 in absolute value, so that's just a circle I'm getting rid of. I can also think of SU of H by making sure my determinant is equal to plus 1. And then PU of H, this is when n equals 2, is going to be, well, perhaps let's do it for any old n, is going to be SU of H divided by, n plus first roots of unity times the identity. So in particular, when n equals 1, then this is just SU divided by plus or minus 1. So because of the size of my matrix, I then have to have more. So in the case I'm interested in, I'm going to have cube roots of unity. Yeah, so it's going to be a triple cover. But in general, it's going to be, whatever size. And this is where there's a difference in those different schemes that I told you. So this is where you've got to be slightly careful. When I'm dealing over the reals, I get the same formula, except there I've only possibly got two roots of unity there, plus or minus the identity. And sometimes that I don't even get minus the identity because I can't have a unit determinant, minus the identity doesn't have determinant 1. So for some cases. So this is where we get to all these different 4 different components that Todd was talking about with plus 1 and minus 1 and forward pointing and backwards pointing. Here I've got a connected group, and so everything's okay. Over the reals, I have to be slightly more complicated. Over the quaternions, scalar multiples of the identity do not act trivially. So the only projectivization I do when I'm doing over the quaternions is via plus or minus 1, providing I've got the right dimension. So this is a significant difference, and that's because of the fact that the quaternions don't commute, whereas I do get, because I'm always, if I'm doing this carefully, in the general context, I always have the matrix acting on one side and the projectivization happening on the other side. And, you know, because I'm English, I like to drive on the left, and so my matrices act on the left, and my projectivization happens on the right. And there are algebraists who like to do things the other way around, but I don't know what side of the road they drive on. Okay? But, and so what would happen there would be a scalar multiple of the identity would be acting on the left. I'm doing it on my right, your left. Very clever, that. And then the projectivization would happen on the right, my left. And so these things don't interact, and so I don't get a scalar multiple. So I have to be a little bit more careful in that case. And in the other cases as well, the Clifford and so forth, the same thing's true. But in this case, I just get a... And so in my case, so when n equals 2, I'm just going to have a triple cover. Gosh, have I really been going an hour and 5 minutes? Goodness me. That's fine. That's fine. I'm actually not so far away from where I wanted to be, which is amazing. Good. So I'm going to finish by sort of talking about how I would go switch between Hermitian forms and so sort of link in. So this would give a concrete analog of this going between the unit disk and the upper half plane. And so what I can do is I've got two Hermitian matrices of the same signature. So same number of positive eigenvalues and negative eigenvalues. Then I take a basis of eigenvectors here and a basis of eigenvectors there, and all I need is a linear map that takes one from one to the other. And then I need to scale things a little bit. But we know one of these theorems from linear algebra, which when I was taught, and therefore when I teach linear algebra, is always called Sylvester's law of inertia. And that is that given two Hermitian forms, or quadratic forms, in the real case, of the same signature, or forms or matrices, so let's call them H and H prime, there exists C such that C star HC is H prime. So in other words, this is a change of basis matrix, and I'm putting a star on there so that I'm still getting a Hermitian matrix out of it. And I call it C because this is usually called Cayley transform. Trying to get the names of as many British mathematicians as I can, because they're usually all French or German. And so if I have this, actually, this means that if I have A in PU of H, then C inverse... Which way round have I done this? C A C inverse is in U of H prime. And so these groups are all just conjugate to each other. And so quite often I don't care about which form I'm going to do. I'm just going to have U, and I'm just going to record the signature. Or So quite often I'm not going to actually bother telling you which what my Hermitian form is. The only thing that's important to me is the signature. It's a little bit like doing vector spaces without giving a choice of basis. And this is all notation that's going to come up. And again, I could do a similar thing with ON1 and SPN1. The analogous group for the octonions is one of the exceptional groups, and it's called F4-20, which doesn't sort of fit into this nice language. Okay, I think I'm going to just stop a couple of minutes early. Maybe I'll tell you in those couple of minutes. Tomorrow, I want to describe in more detail the geometry of complex hyperbolic space. I want to describe the geometry of its boundary. And I also want to, perhaps this would be the third lecture, would be to start classifying isometries and tell you several different methods of classifying them depending on what sort of mathematics you like. So this is where we're going. It's all in the notes, and I hope that the notes are relatively error-free. There's a few places where I would like to improve the exposition, but if you find any mistakes as you're reading, please let me know, and I will. I don't promise to give you chocolate or give you money or whatever for it, but maybe if you find sufficiently many and I remember, then you might get a place in the acknowledgements. Okay.